Today we are going to discuss three broad category of techniques that are used to solve any NLP problem. Before we continue with today's conversation, there are few prerequisites that you need to follow, and if you know those, then it will become easier to understand today's conversation. Now it seems like there is just a lot to learn in terms of prerequisites, so if you still want to continue with this playlist, continue. And as we go through more videos, in each of the videos I will tell you if some of those prerequisites is a must or not. The first one is obviously Python knowledge. So if you go to YouTube, search for Core Basics Python tutorial. In this playlist you need to follow first, I would say, 16 or 17 videos. The second one is machine learning. In YouTube, search Code Basics Machine Learning. This is one of the popular playlists on YouTube, and you can pretty much follow all the videos till, let's say, 17 or 18 videos. And after that, I have some projects, so don't worry too much about projects. If you do projects, of course, it's gonna help you, but in terms of prerequisites for NLP, those many videos are good enough. Search for Code Basics Deep Learning in YouTube. Again, I have a deep learning playlist where I talked about various deep learning concepts. So what you can do is you can start from the beginning and follow all the video till, let's say, till 15. You can skip TensorFlow, GPU benchmarking, and all of this. And then you can also skip computer vision videos because these are specific to the computer vision problem. And at some point I start talking about recurrent neural network that is related to NLP and natural language processing. So you can follow from RNN till Word2Vec here. This one you can skip. And then BERT and BERT classification, these two are important. So if you have seen all these videos, it will help you in this NLP playlist. But if you don't have time to go through a lot of this content, still you can hang on this series, and in individual video, if there is a prerequisite which is a must, I will mention that. We will look at some concrete example to understand those three broad categories. Here is the email where I booked a flight ticket of my mother-in-law. And when Gmail detected this flight ticket in the email, what they did is they did information extraction. So one of the problem areas in NLP world is information extraction. And what I mean by that is, you see this summary at the top. So when you open this email, Google provides a nice summary. When is the flight? Destination, source, flight duration, confirmation number. How did it do that? Well, we looked at regular expression in our last video, if you remember. So if you go to YouTube Code Basics NLP Regex tutorial, I'm talking about this video. They use regular expression. For example, to get confirmation number, you can look for a string such as booking ref, and anything that follows that should be a confirmation number, most likely. So regular expression is a very effective, very accurate way of doing information extraction. Google might be using some other techniques, but I'm just saying that regular expression is one of the techniques that you can use for information extraction. The other problem that we looked at was, if you search for Elon Musk, on the right hand side, it shows you all that information, the key information. This is also using a regular expression, and we looked at this particular use case in this particular video. So if you have not seen this video, please see it. And the regular expression approach is basically rules and heuristic. So that's the first technique. This doesn't involve any machine learning, deep learning, nothing. It's just basically rules and heuristic that you solve, that you use to solve a given problem. The other popular use case in NLP is text classification, which is spam detection. So here is another real email from my Gmail, where, you know, someone sent me an email saying that there is $55 million lying in an account and I should claim it. And they detect some keywords. Here, say you see urgent business assistance, then USD 55 million. No one is giving you 55 million for free. And the email comes from some personal Gmail address. And these are the indication that it could be a spam. And the way the spam detection can work in a primitive way is you take the text from your email, you convert it to a number vector, because machine learning models don't understand text. You have to convert it to number. And count vectorizer is one of the techniques. Now, if you don't know about count vectorizer, don't worry. I have a video for it. So if you go to YouTube and search for Code Basics Naive Bayes, you'll find my two videos. And if you look at the second video, I have talked about the count vectorizer. So you see, you take each of the words and you count the occurrence of those words in a given document. Again, if you don't understand, don't worry about it. Just think in your head that there is some way to convert text into numbers, okay? And you feed that to a naive Bayes classifier. So naive Bayes classifier is a statistical machine learning technique that can be used for classification purpose. And in that particular video, I use count vectorizer and naive Bayes classifier for doing spam detection. Now, if you look at the pipeline of this approach, you have raw text, then you have number vector, and you use statistical machine learning. So here, this pipeline that you're seeing is called like NLP pipeline. So in natural language processing pipeline, usually you will have raw text and you will do some pre-processing. There are things like lemmatization, removing punctuations, TF-IDF, vectorization technique. There are so many techniques and we'll cover them all of them one by one. So don't worry. Don't worry about these jargons too much. For now, just understand that in this approach, there is some way to convert text into numbers and there is some other way of doing classification by using this naive Bayes classifier. So that's technique number two, which is machine learning, or you can call it statistical machine learning. Now, the problem with this approach would be that the simple count vectorizer approach would be that in your training sample, let's say you have samples like this, hurry up for an offer to win cash. The second sentence is you want a laptop, because when you train machine learning model, you feed a lot of training samples. And after machine learning model is trained, let's say now you give this new sentence for prediction, rush for this great deal to win money. Now it might not have seen all these words, rush, money, deal, all these words. And if you just use count vectorizer, it might not work, because then for this new text, it will not produce that number vector in an accurate way. So you can use a deep learning technique called sentence embedding or a word embedding. And we'll go over those techniques in the future videos as well. But if you are just curious, I did another series on deep learning where I explain about BERT, which is Google's transformer model, a language model which can be used for generating sentence embedding. So if you look at what is BERT, if you just Google, you will find my video. I will explain how this BERT works. And then there is another video, follow-up video. So if you see those two videos, 46 and 47 video, you will get a good understanding of how BERT can be used to generate sentence embedding. And the beauty is, the way it generates sentence embedding, look at these two sentence embedding. They look kind of similar. See, here is 5, here is 5.1. Here is 9, it's 9, 10, 10, 0.3. So the numbers are, they're kind of close, you know. That concept is called cosine similarity. These two are cosine similar. And I have given just a dummy example so that you understand. But the idea is, you take two sentences, and using this sentence embedding approach, the number vector you generate is very similar. And now if you use these two vectors into your naive Bayes classifier, it will accurately predict the new sentences. Like the accurately predict a new sentence that it has not seen during the training phase. So I'm gonna give you a demo of Hugging Face. So if you just Google Hugging Face Sentence Transformer, and if you go here, and if you look at all the sentence transformer, let's say I'm going to sort it by most likes, and this is the first thing that I see. So what I'm gonna do is basically I put all this text here. Okay, so let me put this text. I'm just gonna do the whole thing again so that you kind of get an idea. Hello, baby Yoda, my baby. Okay, so when you say compute, what it is doing, it will compute the sentence embedding for the first one, and then it will compute the sentence embedding for these three. We are comparing these three with the first one, and then it will say how similar they are. It uses a concept of cosine similarity. And if you don't know about cosine similarity, you can search code basics cosine similarity. I have explained in a very simple language, as if like a high school student can understand it easily, what is cosine similarity. So now here, look at this. What this is saying is, hurry up for an offer to win cash is kind of matching with this. See, there is 70% similarity between these two sentences. But I love Baby Yoda, me coming to India, right? Like, I love paratha. Let's see. I love paratha. Oh my God. 0.006. There is no similarity between paratha and winning cash and hurry up. Oh, by the way, if you win cash, you can buy a lot of paratha. But anyways, you get an idea. So these sentence embedders are based on deep learning techniques. So that's the third technique. Okay, so just to summarize, there are three broad category of techniques to solve any NLP problem: rules and heuristic, machine learning, and deep learning. I hope you like this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. I have taken a lot of inspiration for this series from my friend Anuj Gupta's book, The Practical Natural Language Processing, and I'm gonna provide a link of that book in a video description below. I will see you in the next video.